Thank you very much, Peter. So that was very kind invitation from you to receive. I'm very glad to be here today. And indeed, I'm going to present a little bit my work that I'm doing right now at the University of Texas at El Paso, and also the work I was doing back in France at the University of Picardy Jules Verne as PhD student there. And so I will try to answer this question, 3D printing of batteries, is that a fiction or is it already a reality? And so, first of all, I wanted to share with you the scheme of lithium-ion battery. So lithium-ion battery right now are everywhere. You have one in your laptop just in front of you or in your cell phone. Okay, so this is something that we use every day. And basically what I want you to understand is that if you take a look at a commercial lithium-ion battery, it follows a 2D architectures, okay? It's kind of a planar stacking of planar foils, okay? That are divided into different components. You have two electrodes, a positive one and a negative one. And in between you have a separator, okay, in order to avoid short circuits. And you have also current collectors, of course, on both ends. And everything, the whole structures, actually is soaked within an electrolyte. And in commercial cell, well, the electrolyte is liquid. And so what will happen is that during your charge of your battery, well, the lithium ion will move from the positive electrode towards the negative one. And the reverse phenomenon, sorry, will take place during discharge. And you can see the electrons are flowing actually through the external circuits here. So having said that, well, you know, I was saying commercial batteries are following a two-dimensional architecture, so planar one. But thanks to 3D printing right now, what we can really imagine is to move from conventional 2D architectures of the battery towards 3D electrodes. Through the architectures. And so here are some designs. You can see the geroid one, for example, it's very complicated designs of the battery. But why is that interesting? Well, there is here a motivation, and the main motivation is that thanks to this kind of three-dimensional architectures of the battery, well, we can enhance the power performances of the battery, meaning that you will be able, for example, to charge your cell phone much faster. Okay, this is the main motivation. And how is that done? Well, thanks to 3D printing, you can see that we can have these intricate designs, and that leads to higher specific surface, exchange surface area. So this is the main motivation, but there is also another very interesting objective, another motivation. And I really like to take this example, you know, of smart glasses. And so at the top of your screen, you can see the conventional design. So this is the smart glasses that are commercially available if you go to supermarket. And if you see that, for example, you can take a look at the battery, and the battery is just one huge block on one side of the frame of the object, right? And what we can imagine now, thanks to 3D printing, is to be able to hide the complete shape conformable battery within the whole frame of the final object, in that case, smart glasses, okay? And of course, this is in order to enhance the energy storage capability here. So smart glasses are just an example, okay? But of course, this can be transposed to many, many other applications, for portable application, for also transportation. Here, it's just a scheme of some aircraft where the battery, for example, could be hidden in the future, maybe, into the available space, you know, of the walls of the plane. We could also imagine to hide the battery within the wall frame, you know, of an electric car, for example. This is something also that have been proposed. And right now, one of the projects that we are having at the University of Texas at El Paso, we are collaborating with Sandia National Lab and Northrop Grumman. Northrop Grumman is a company that are sending some satellites, okay, building satellites. And basically what they are interested in right now is to hide the battery, okay, to 3D print shape conformable batteries in order to hide it within the frame of a satellite. Here, it's just a representation of what we call a CubeSat. This is a very small satellite, so I think 10 centimeters per 10 centimeters per 10. So here are just the motivation, okay? And so when I was back in France, actually, I started my work on this particular project of 3D printing batteries back in 2017. At the time, there were not many studies in literature. And basically what we decided to start was to focusing this research on a very cheap process, okay, a very affordable one, and we decided to focus 3D printing of batteries on thermoplastic matter extrusion, also called fused deposition modeling. And so I'm pretty sure you are all familiar with this process. So it uses a thermoplastic filament, okay, inserted into a heated nozzle, and by displacement of this nozzle, well, we are able to deposit layer after layer the fused material. Basically, here, the main goal of this PhD thesis that I've done, well, that was to create and to make composite filaments, okay, corresponding to each part of a classical lithium-ion battery I just introduced previously. So meaning, I during my PhD thesis, well, I developed particular composite filaments for the positive electrode, a second one for the negative electrode, a third one for the separator, etc., etc. Many different filaments corresponding to each part of the battery. And here there was really a you know, a huge compromise, of course, between mechanical performances on one hand and electrochemical performances on the other hand, because of course we need to load, you know, enough polymer matrix within the filament in order to allow good printability. But at the same time, of course, what we wanted to do, well, it's to print a battery, right? And so in order to print a battery, well, you need to load a very high loading of active material for the parts, the components that you want to print. And so here, for example, I was using very commercially available material. So graphite, it's very common for the negative electrodes as active material, or also lithium iron phosphate, which is very classical material for the positive electrode. So I will not enter today into details for each filament, but just wanted to show you for this specific filament here corresponding to the negative electrodes. And here is a scanning electron microscopy cross-sectional image. And here the filament was based on, so that was PLA as polymer matrix. So PLA stands for polylactic acid, which is a very classical polymer for thermoplastic matter extrusion process. Okay. And here, as you can see, what we tried to do was to enhance as high as possible the active material loading. In that case here, that was graphite, okay, in order to confer and to enhance the power, I mean, the battery performances of this particular electrode. And so you can see here the loading was up to 62% in weight percentage of graphite, which was very, very high. And so, of course, the resulting filament, well, it was particularly brittle, okay, because it's very composite, as you can see from the image, from the images. Well, you can see the graphite is really well dispersed within the wall polymer matrix, okay, it's very homogeneous. And nonetheless, as it was very, very brittle, well, we had to add some additives, and in that case, we add the PEG-DME500, which stands for polyethylene glycol dimethylator, okay. This is a plasticizer here, and thanks to this plasticizer, well, the filament became, much, much more flexible, and so it allows printability. So you have to imagine that this is just for one filament, okay, for the negative electrode, but as I was saying, we developed many, many different filaments, and each of them, they have, I will say, mechanical properties that are slightly different. And so, they are not comparable at all with commercial filaments. Commercial filaments, well, they are very easy to print, okay, because it's mainly polymer matrix, almost 99%, so you don't have any issue. But when your filament is very highly loaded with active material, well, it becomes very, very, very brittle sometimes. And so you need to find the right printing parameters, or sometimes to make some printer modification in order to avoid some extrusion issues. That, for example, the filament will break within the driving gears. Also, you will have a filament clogging, within the nozzle. So depending on the kind of filaments, depending on the part, well, filament was either very brittle or sometimes very, very flexible. And sometimes we were also having this other issue here, the filament buckling, and of course leading to other extrusion issues here. So from the different filaments that I've developed corresponding to each part of the battery, well, the idea was to print with a very affordable printer. You can see here, this is like a less than $1,000 printer, okay, desktop printer, and the idea was to print the complete lithium-ion battery in one single print, in one shot, okay? And here you can see a scanning electron microscopy transversal image of the complete battery that we just printed. And so here you can see that first of all, on top of the bed of the printer, well, we printed the positive electrodes, okay? That's this layer here. And on top of it, well, we printed directly the separator, okay? The second layer is the separator. And then on top of it, we printed our third filament, which was here, the negative electrode. And so here we had kind of a complete battery, okay? And after soaking this within a liquid electrolyte that is commercially available, well, we introduced this item that we just printed into a coin cell that was empty, okay? We put our sample in it, and we were able to connect it to a galvanostat in order to determine the performances of our battery. And at the time, that was a great achievement because we were, that was the first time that a group reported the 3D printing and of a functional lithium-ion battery. And here you can see there is a graph, so maybe you're not familiar with that because it's really from the battery field, okay? But basically, we were here able to demonstrate that, yes, the battery was working. So we 3D printed a battery that is functional. That was quite amazing at the time. So of course, there is many next step to consider. What I just show, well, it's still planar, as you can see what I printed, okay? And as I told you at the very beginning, well, we want really to move towards three-dimensional architectures of the battery. Here, for example, we can imagine in blue to print the positive electrode, and here in red, the negative one, and in white, within the structure, well, it will be the separator electrolyte, okay? And of course, in order to do that, well, we need multi-materials printing options. And so we have done some tests. Here is a multi-material printing options that we just connected to our printer, okay? It allows us actually to print up to 5 filaments at the same time. But it's kind of tricky because it works pretty well with commercially available filaments. As you can see the picture on the right side, where it is something that I printed and that was done with commercially available filaments, okay? But as soon as we are talking about composite filaments that are either brittle or very flexible, well, it becomes immediately very, very tricky. And so I think there is really a lot of work that must be done in order to develop multi-material options in the future, particularly for composite materials. So what about other 3D printing processes, right? Right now, I just talked about this fused deposition modeling process, but actually in literature, if you take a look, well, most of the work that has been done on 3D printing of batteries, well, it has been done on this process here that I call DIY, direct ink writing, okay? There is many studies on this. If you take a look in literature, well, you see very few studies on selective laser sintering, and still very few studies also in stereolithography apparatus. I worked a little bit with both recently, and right now I will just focus my next slide on stereolithography apparatus, okay, because that photopolymerization actually is what I'm working with right now at the University of Texas at El Paso. And so, of course, with this process, that photopolymerization, well, we're still interested in printing batteries, right? And so, well, it uses as a material source for the printer resin. And so in that case, well, we start from a pretty common resin, okay, composed of polymer matrix and photoinitiator, in which we introduce some active material for the battery, just as the same as that I did with a filament previously, okay? Once we have done that and once the resin is ready, well, we try to 3D print this resin. Sometimes it is a bit complicated sometimes because, of course, the solid particles that are inside, well, it can, you know, prevent the good printing because you have some light scattering sometimes. Anyway, it works, okay? We have very promising results here. And then third step, what we do is we recover the items that we just printed, okay, loaded with battery ceramic particles, and we perform some thermal post-processing. This thermal post-processing actually allows us to remove the polymer matrix. So we just, maintained here at this step, just the active material. And so this allows us then to get better battery performances, of course. And last step, of course, is to characterize and to quantify the battery performances of the items that we just printed. So this is the work that we are currently doing here at UTEP. And so it's pretty recent, but it's working pretty well. Finally, I just wanted to say a few words about one of the very exciting projects that we are doing here also at the University of Texas at El Paso in collaboration with NASA. So as you can see here, we are still a little bit in the fiction, okay, because what NASA, they want, well, it's to 3D print batteries from the lunar and Martian in-situ resources. So basically, right now we are working with them so they can extract some battery materials from the lunar and maybe in the future from the Martian regolith. So regolith is the rocks, you know, that are in both surfaces. And basically we extract these battery materials, and what they want to do, of course, is to 3D print batteries from these materials that they extracted. And in this project, actually, they're with this company, which is called Icon. And actually Icon, they just have this contract with NASA, and maybe in the few coming years, they will be able to 3D print the first houses on the surface of the moon. And so one of the goals they want, you know, is to be able to hide the energy storage device within the walls, for example, of the houses, you know, because these houses, well, they will have some shapes that are non-conformable, right? So it's pretty exciting project right now, and of course this could lead, you know, to 3D print maybe batteries in order to replace the batteries for drones, for rovers in the future, without having the necessity to import materials from Earth to the moon, for example, right? We could just use the materials that are available on the moon or on Mars direct. So very exciting project I wanted to share with you. So to conclude today, 3D printing of batteries, is that a fiction or a reality? Well, you can see that it is a reality, right? There are some very exciting research done on this topic right now. But I will say nonetheless that for now it's only at the laboratory scale, and there is still a huge amount of research that must be done to be able to find this in a niche application and for, you know, industrial application, for example. So nonetheless, well, it has a really huge potential, I think, in the future, and I have no doubt that we will see the integration of this kind of shape conformable batteries in many applications, aerospace, portable, biomedical, or even transportation. So thank you very much, and I look forward to answer your question. Thank you.